President Frank, as I indicated, his whole life has been one of disruption. As the Minister of Mexico, he reformed the nation's healthcare system, and which provided essentially medical care free for everyone. And what's really significant to me, that innovative change, that disruptive change that he made to the Mexican healthcare system still has survived several governments after he put it in place with President Fox. And then he went and became the dean of the Chad School of Public Health at Harvard. Again, dramatic innovation and disruption of the status quo that made it a better place. And before that, it was the Gates Foundation and the World Health Organizations and many other organizations that President Frank made better. President Frank, as an MD from the University of Mexico and a PhD from Michigan, and he has all the skills, all the capabilities and credibility to take the University of Miami into the second century and to make it a better place and a more sophisticated place through innovation and disruption. So ladies and gentlemen, let me present to you the sixth president of the University of Miami, Dr. Julio Frank.
Thank you very much, Chuck. It is really my great pleasure to help introduce the final session of this year's Real Estate Impact Conference. Now in its sixth year, the conference is an outstanding effort by the University of Miami's Schools of Architecture and of Business Administration, and really illustrates how interdisciplinary collaboration allows us to have a whole that's larger than the sum of its parts. Now, you may not know this, but the University of Miami has real estate in its DNA. Because architecture and real estate are forever linked to the history of our university. It was exactly 91 years ago this past Saturday, on February the 4th, when a visionary developer of Coral Gables, the visionary developer of Coral Gables, George Merrick, was joined by his fellow UM founders and 7,000 citizens to lay the cornerstone of the university's first building, named after his father, another father-son's connection there. Merrick provided 160 acres, a $5 million matching grant in 1925, and an extraordinary plan for a Pan-American university at the heart of his city beautiful, as Coral Gables is known. Merrick would not live to see his dream fully realized, but he viewed the University of Miami as his most important legacy. And so we were born out of the vision of a real estate developer, and now the Real Estate Impact Conference is a testament to the strong support for the university provided by today's real estate industry and to the dedicated service of our real estate advisory board members. Board members are directly involved in the life of the university, appearing as guest lecturers in our classrooms, serving as mentors, providing internships for our students, and hire many of our alumni as they start their career. On behalf of the university, we thank you for your continued service and support. Real estate is a vital sector of the national and global economy that shapes the places where we live, work, and carry out our daily lives. As the world continues to urbanize rapidly, we're faced with new challenges for the finance, design, and construction of communities that are more viable, healthy, inclusive, and resilient. These are complex challenges that will increasingly require interdisciplinary solutions. And the University of Miami is uniquely positioned to play a leadership role in the education of a new generation of leaders, innovators, and entrepreneurs who can face these challenges. Our focus on problem-based interdisciplinary collaboration across departments and schools seeks to promote our aspiration not only to be an excellent, but also a relevant university, a university that is connected to the critical issues facing the local, national, and global communities to which we belong. Now, real estate education at the University of Miami boasts a Master's of Real Estate Development and Urbanism, based in the School of Architecture, an undergraduate major and an MBA in real estate programs in the School of Business Administration and an LLM in real property development in our law school. These three academic programs in the schools of architecture, business, and law, and their faculty actually collaborate very intensely through shared courses, student projects, competitions, research, and events such as this conference. Our real estate programs also partner with other academic disciplines at UM, pursuing research and projects to advance the connections between health and the built environment, resilient design and development, and the integration of technology in buildings and smart cities. Students are coming from all over the world to study real estate at UM, and South Florida provides us with one of the most dynamic laboratories for the study of real estate and urbanisms. Through your generous support and active engagement with our real estate programs and students, the University of Miami is poised to play a leadership role in shaping the future of this global industry. So I thank you for your participation, your engagement, and your support. Now, for our featured keynote conversation, we have two outstanding global leaders of the real estate industry. David Simon is the chairman and CEO of the Simon Property Group, SPG, which owns, manages, and develops retail properties across North America, Europe, and Asia. SPG is the world's largest publicly traded real estate company and the only real estate company in the S&P 100 index. The company was named Fortune World's Most Admired Real Estate Company for the seventh time in 2016. David Simon himself has been repeatedly recognized as one of the best performing CEOs for his management and leadership of SPG, and that includes the Harvard Business Review list of the best performing global CEOs, Barron's list of the world's best 30 CEOs, and as the number one CEO in real estate industry by Institutional Investor for five consecutive years. Under David's leadership, SPG has also been recognized as a global leader in corporate sustainability. Now, leading today's conversation with David is Stuart Miller, CEO of the Lennar Corporation, the former chair of the University of Miami Board of Trustees, and a great friend of our university. Stuart is an innovative and renowned business leader who has led the rapid growth and diversification of Lennar since 1997. He co-founded and served as chairman of the board of Lennar Property Corporation until its sale in February of 2005. Stuart and his family have had an indelible impact on the University of Miami, where he has served with distinction as a member of the Board of Trustees since 2002, as did his father before him, who also chaired our board. The Miller family has given more than $200 million to the university, primarily to the Miller School of Medicine, the Miller Center for Contemporary Judaic Studies, the School of Law, the Frost School of Music, and Intercollegiate Athletics. And in December, just last December, we opened the Lennar Foundation Medical Center, a truly spectacular state-of-the-art facility that brings UHealth, the University of Miami Academic Health System, to our Coral Gables campus. So we're in for a great treat. Please join me in welcoming two outstanding corporate and community leaders, David Simon and Stuart Miller.
Thank you, President Frank, and thank you, Chuck Cobb. You've highlighted a couple of things, but the first that you didn't mention is that it's after 5 o'clock on a Friday afternoon, and everybody here is ready to drink, and we
Open
are,
bar.
David, all that stands between them and the bar. And so, you know, I just want to share one quick thing with all of you that David and I had an opportunity to chat before we came to the podium today. And the one thing that we found that we completely agreed on is that we are two CEOs that have absolutely no and perhaps bad personalities. So we're here to entertain you today. David, we better pick it up a little
I
bit.
I agree. Let's bring in the drinks here. Can we serve?
So listen, to start out, I want to get personal a little bit. You know, I listened carefully to Chuck Cobb. I wasn't sure if he was saying that there are two spoiled brats on stage, two that were born with the silver spoon. But on a more serious note, sometimes I feel like I was robbed at birth, because the one thing that I was never given was the opportunity to say that I personally was born of humble beginnings. I did it all on my own,
sure,
and I turned nothing into a pot of gold. You probably feel the same way. Can you tell us a little bit about your personal history, your background, how you grew up?
Well, let's see. That's a tough one. You know, we got introduced as disruptors and innovators. I'm basically just a disruptor, so let's just go on record there. You know, I think with I don't know your father. Didn't know your father, but I think with an entrepreneur, bootstrap father, I mean, it is tumultuous, right? So, you know, he was born of no means in Brooklyn, moved to the Bronx, went to Bronx High School of Science, got transferred out where they took the guys that could add and subtract to, you know, that were afraid in the Army to give him any kind of weapons of mass destruction. This, you know, he would have really hurt people. But he could add and subtract, and he, you know, settled in Indianapolis. And it was, I basically had a pretty normal childhood. I went to public school. I went to, I went to a public university, Indiana. And, you know, but he was larger than life, and somehow, I don't know how, but it kind of rubbed off on me. And, you know, we didn't really have money. I didn't figure out I had money probably till I was, 15 or 16. And then that's, so the good news is it wasn't, the silver spoon was there, but it wasn't there from the beginning. You know, when you have a father like that, some people rebel against it, which I certainly did. But on the other hand, it does instill in you a certain drive that, you know, you want to outdo the old man, okay? And I don't know if that was in your case, but his drive, I think, is probably the thing that he passed on the most to me. And my background before I went back to the family business really was, you know, in New York and Wall Street, and that gave me a great exposure to stuff outside of real estate. So I know there are a lot of family businesses here, and they may have second or third generations, but I think it's really important to see whether or not you can go out and do something on your own. And, you know, I had a reasonably successful career before I went back home. So that helped give me some, you know, when you come back to your family business, you want to add something to the table. And I think that background helped a lot.
So what did the foundation look like? And, you know, what's the landscape of Simon Properties today look like? Just juxtapose those.
Well, it was funny. When I went back home, it was June of 1990. And I was left Wall Street. I was at Wasserstein Perella, First Boston, in the kind of the corporate finance merger group. So I had done a lot of deals, you know, Philip Morris, Kraft Foods, Northwest Air, all sorts of things outside of real estate. And all my buddies on Wall Street said, well, you're so lucky. Wall Street at that point was kind of dead. There were not a lot of deals. And I went back home and I go, man, you don't know what the hell's going on in real estate. And listen, in the 90s, early 90s, that was a real estate recession. This last one, and, you know, housing's probably a little different, but the last one in 8 and 9...
Just remember, you're talking the home builder.
Okay, I know, okay, I got right. it. I just dawned
this,
on me,
this
okay?
This was a doozy.
Okay, that was a doozy. What? Actually, I thought it was... I thought it was child's play, to be honest with you.
Okay, right.
But, you know, in the early 90s, it was, you know, doggy dog. And there was no liquidity in the market. We weren't public. And I spent the first two or three years really doing, you know, stabilization, trying to corral the company, lots of development. For those of you who know my dad, every deal, Michael Comrass is here, every deal that somebody would bring in, he liked. You know, we were involved in Sunset. Right, Michael? Yes, yeah. So the good, the bad, the indifferent, whatever. You know, I wish you the best of luck, okay? And, you know, if you, I want to see you and Don Wood in the same room and see, you know, I want to see that dynamic. So invite me, invite me back. But we had, I mean, we were in workout mode and, you know, we went public in 93, which gave us some stability, but it really was, you know, it really was until 95, frankly, till 96, where things got a little bit better in the retail real estate world. And from that, you know, I had this financial background, good instincts, M&A oriented, and, you know, we've been able to, you know, have a pretty good run since, you know, 95 and a lot of M&A deals, and just grew the company. I did believe in scale because I think, you know, real estate is capital intensive. For our point of view, our retailers, the bigger, better relationship you have with them, the more you can accomplish with them together as partners. Your overhead can be spread out over many properties. It gives you lots of opportunities, you know, globally, you know, with size. And, you know, we've since then, it really has been a pretty good run. And all these awards, I think all these awards, I think that's all done. I think I'm done getting any more. I appreciate, Mr. President, for you to do that. But I think those are, you know, given what's going on in the retail world, I'm done with awards, okay? I got no more awards coming, okay?
So what does Simon Properties look like today? What is the general scale of the company today?
Well, our equity market cap is around $60 billion, and our funds from operation, which for those of you essentially is net income plus depreciation, because in theory, real estate never depreciates, so that's kind of how companies are valuable, is about $4.2 billion. I mean, that gives you a kind of, the asset base is probably close to, you know, $95 to $100 billion. So that kind of gives you, and we're in the U.S. in the mall business. We've got about 100 malls. We've got about 70 outlet centers. We own Sawgrass Mills, the Mills product, and then we're in Europe through Klépierre and an outlet joint venture, and then we have outlets in Asia, and that's basically you know, what we have.
And outlet wise, about
70 outlets, you know, domestically and throughout the world. Okay. Which has been a very good business. A lot of, you know, it's been a little tougher recently because a lot of these outlets are tourism oriented, and with the stronger dollar, and, you know, it's, you know, we've seen a little softness in that business, but generally a very profitable business, not just for us but for retailers. I got in the outlet business in I think 2000. Shows you how stupid I am. So I in 2000 I did a joint venture with Chelsea Property Group in Orlando. We built an outlet center. We redesigned it, made it kind of a circle so you could walk it easier. If you've been to outlets, a lot of them are spread out like this. Redesigned it, upgraded the mix, the look, et cetera. And we had invested in technology back then. We had like a $30 million write-off. Remember, that was in the days of web.com and, you know, all those companies. So I think I felt like I had to show Wall Street I was a bad tech investor, but at least I knew how to real estate. So we put $4 million of equity and I sold it back to Chelsea Property Group, I think for 50, so it's like 11X in 2 years, which is not bad, right?
It's good.
It's good. But then I bought the company, and I think I, you know, I bought the company in 04, and God knows what I paid for that that outlet if I had kept it. So it's been a great business for us. I think you're involved in the outlet business now, aren't you, a little bit?
Not really.
But I thought you're doing that deal, right?
Which deal?
Aren't you doing with... you're not doing the deal with Candlestick, right? Or
right with Macerich.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry, am I not supposed to use that name? But
No, yeah, you can. I don't care.
We are involved. That's right. Through that one.
Okay.
Right.
In the retail?
Huh?
Are you in the retail too?
We're partners in the retail, but we're not driving the bus.
But you didn't call me, right? You didn't call me. Okay.
We tried. You didn't answer. So in any case. Don't throw me under the bus. I'm the interviewer.
So I'm just saying, when you hit me up for Miami, you better somebody else call me.
Oh boy, it's getting hot in here. So let's.
No. I think you'll do a great job. You know, it's funny because we looked at that when DeBartolo. We looked at that site when they were going to do the. This is way back when, DeBartolo, big shareholder of ours. About DeBartolo. So I think it's a very, actually, it's a great site.
It's going to be interesting.
Great opportunity.
So coming closer to home.
Yeah.
I mean, we are a South Florida audience here, right?
Yeah, sure.
So let's talk about your landscape a little bit here, your footprint here in South Florida. What have you got? What are you doing? And what's the thinking here?
You know, we love South Florida. And in fact, when we were talking about it in the other room, but when... You know, when this new tax, I want you to find me a really nice big house that I could buy, okay?
Got it.
Because I'm thinking that it's likely that state income tax will no longer be deducted for federal reasons. And we're moving, okay? We're moving here. So I need you, because of our personality, I may need help getting into the right golf club. Can you handle that for me?
Can handle that.
Okay. All right. So
Chuck can handle that, right?
Okay. We'll talk afterwards. But so we are partners with Brickell with Swire and the Whitman family, which I think is really going to be. It's going to take time, but I think it's going to be a really cool development. And I was just there before I came over. But we're proud to be part of that. It's going to take time, but it's a great design. The tenant mix is evolving. And I think Michael said it. I mean, I do envision that to be a place where people, can hang out and gather. And what's unique about our company, so we're, we can partner with the Whitmans and the Swire. At the same time, we can partner with the Sofers up at Aventura. And somehow we manage, everybody gets along. So we're partners in Aventura. We own Dadeland Mall. We own Sawgrass Mills, which we've expanded repeatedly. Falls, Miami International, which is kind of it's actually a very hidden, nice shopping mall. And, what else am I missing? We sold Sunset, to Federal just recently. And then we have Boca Town Center, which is, further up north. So this is a hugely important area to us. Sawgrass Mills, probably I'll just give you a sense of what I think about what we can do. We bought Sawgrass Mills in 07. It had roughly $55 million NOI. Today it has over 130. When people want to say retail is going out of business, there's a lot of negative headlines out there. But the fact is, if you can diversify the mix, you can bring in the right retailers, you can make it, a real part of the community. You can bring in tourism, you can grow your business. So that's been a real treat for us too.
Yeah, and so that's kind of a great pivot point. To kind of the three words in today's world that I feel that I live by, and that is evolve or die. And I kind of want to agitate
it. Can you limp along?
You can, but okay. It's not. Right. Wall Street won't view that as the favored way to go. You won't get any more awards.
Right.
So You know, I want to read a quote from, and this is not putting you on the spot. I'm just telling you, this is nice, easy, softball.
Is this a good personality?
It's good. This is from a recent Fortune article where they were talking about your Roosevelt Field mall up in New York. And they set up the conversation. They say, hundreds of shopping centers across the U.S. are facing obsolescence, abandoned by shoppers who are getting online or getting choosier about where they shop. But Roosevelt Fields shows that there is still a lot of life in that American mainstay, the suburban mall. The 2.4 million square foot center generates about $1,000 a foot in annual retail sales, according to real estate research firm, more than twice the national average for shopping centers. And it's a combination of novelty, technology, and consumer pampering. Roosevelt Fields embodies the strategy that helped its owner, Simon Properties, navigate retail's crisis to stay on top of the mall world. So I think it's a good setup for the fact that you start with a foundation back in the 90s. It was a critical commercial downturn and liquidity crunch.
Right.
You evolve through difficult financial times, you recraft a business, and now you find yourself on technology's
doorstep. Having to do it again, right.
Having to think it again, do it again, and reconfigure the way that you approach the market. Roosevelt Fields, as you read the article, really highlights some innovative approaches to the retail business. There are tons of articles talking about the death of retail.
Sure.
We see new ownership for Abercrombie.
Yeah.
We see the questions around Macy's and some of the other big boxes out there. What's a retailer to do? How are you navigating the transition, evolving, and certainly not limping or dying?
Well, there's a lot of headwinds and there's a lot of cross currents. The biggest of which is there's just too much retail space. You know, there's 24 square feet per capita. And if you look at, you know, France or London, you know, or even Canada, it's, you know, anywhere between 3 feet to 10 feet. So we are going to have obsolescence in retail real estate. But I will tell you the one common denominator that I've seen is not the internet. You know, why does a mall go bad? It's not the internet took the business away, whatever. It's really the fact that, think about a mall that was built 40, 50, 60 years ago, right? And the fact is the demographics of that neighborhood changed. That's the one common denominator. Take Sunset Place. Not a mall, but, you know, not a good design. I think Michael will attest to that, right? So he's redoing it. But you know what? You can't replicate the location. Great location. So I think as long as our real estate is well located, you know, it'll evolve. The other point is we've got, if you look at the malls compared to malls throughout the world, we have way too much of the space dedicated to department stores. And so we've got to, the big challenge for our industry is we're going to have to recapture that space and do a lot of different things with it. So for instance, you know, I made a deal, and I'm not going to, but with a mall here in Miami, to take one department store to put in probably the best community fitness operator that exists in this country. And I think that'll give it a sense of community. That pool, tennis, restaurant, spa, you know, et cetera. So it's not just a fitness club, but really kind of what I'd call a community center. And to take out a department store, because I think that's what the community wants. And, you know, we just have too much, generally the mall has too much space dedicated to department stores. And the one thing what do CEOs have to do, right? We have to balance the product and the profitability, right? And unfortunately, not to be negative on the retailer industry, but what they've been more they have not invested in their product, okay? And if you don't invest in your product, I don't care what business you're in, you're gonna fail. And you know, I think as long as we have the conviction that, you know, that, and we invest in our product, I think the consumer will come. Now, we have to make them all smarter, we gotta provide better service, we gotta provide search capabilities, we gotta maybe eventually provide fulfillment, we've gotta diversify the mix, we've got to reduce the reliance on apparel. We've got to bring mixed use. We've added 3,000 units of either apartments or hotels in our portfolio, which is pretty good for us because we're not really a core, you know, we're not an apartment builder or hotel builder. But if we do all of that, and there's no one thing to do, but if you do all of that and you're well located, I think the mall will continue to evolve and be an important part of commerce. But at the end of the day, our retailers need to invest in their stores. And what we're seeing is they're investing way too much on technology front, trying to keep up with Amazon, which could be a mistake. And between, you know, free shipping, returns, And their store's not looking well. I mean, they're, you know, a lot of them are on the ropes. The other thing that's come into our business is, you know, the private equity. You know, as we all know, retail is very cyclical, right? Every retailer has unbelievable moments of success, and then they're out of fashion, or they have competition, and they wane a little bit. But that's all solvable. Like a Coach is an example, with a good balance sheet, you know, they grew, they were hot, and they lost their thing, and they're coming back. But if you're been owned by a private equity that's either taken out dividends or levered up the company, you know, you can't survive that. So we have our work cut out, but I'll tell you, we have an unbelievable amount of conviction that the consumer will continue to go where the retail critical mass is at its highest. And I think in a lot of cases, that's the mall. And bringing kind of indoor, outdoor activities and all of that stuff, I think will continue to be a place for the consumer to come.
So let me, there are a lot of subtopics in that answer.
Sure.
There's the component of perhaps being over-retailed nationally,
Sure.
repurposing certain parts of the space. I think that as you think through foundation, difficult times, moving forward, building a brand and a company into something much bigger, it's really a lot about being on the front foot.
Mm-hmm.
So in today's technology world, in today's changing landscape around retail, what does that front foot look like? What does the entry into today's retail look like? And I even wonder, you know, do we get to see a glimpse of some of that as we look at Brickell Square and the newer additions right here in South Florida? What are we gonna see happen in retail?
Well, I think you've got to have, you know, it's like the gaming business, okay? You know, you can game online, right? But if you go to a Steve Wynn product, you know what you're going to get. You're going to get great service. You're going to have a good-looking facility, and you're going to have diverse things to do, whether it's go to the pool, whether it's gamble, whether it's shop. And I think our industry, has to take that kind of approach. Is I think it does start with, very importantly, have a good product, good-looking product, architecturally. And that could be different, you know, here in South Florida versus Indianapolis, mm-hmm. which is okay, right?
Right.
But you've got to have a good-looking product because it is too easy to shop online. And you've got to improve your service. So, and for a mall owner, we've never really had a relationship with the consumer. You know, we always relied on the retailer to do that, right? So we would rely on the retailer, the big retailers, promotions or otherwise, to drive traffic to the center. That paradigm has shifted. So it's going to be up to us to drive traffic directly to the consumer, establish a relationship with them.
So how do you do that?
You got to communicate with them.
What are we going to see?
Yeah, we're going to end up communicating with them, knowing what their preferences are. You know, and it's very interesting, the number one complaint that which is counterintuitive, right? Because nobody goes to the mall, but what's the number one complaint every mall customer has? Parking, right? Somebody said it. Okay, parking. So, you know, how do we bring technology to bear to improve the parking experience? Ultimately the return and fulfillment experience. And I think, I'm not really sure where it all evolved, but if we can make the mall a smart box, so take search. You know, what's so great about the internet? Because you can search, right? It's pretty easy to search on the internet, right? Well, when you go to the mall, you can't search. Let's say you want a black dress, okay? And you don't know, you know, you normally go to Gap or Banana, you know, you don't really know who's got the new black dress.
I don't look so good in a black dress.
Well, don't sell yourself short, okay? But if there was an ability to search while you're in the mall, right? Then I think it's going to increase the length of stay and also get you to visit other stores. So here's what's interesting, and this has always boggled my mind. So the average big mall has at least 100 stores. 5 years ago, 6 years ago, they would go to 6 or so on average, right? So think about that. So you have 100 stores, they only go to 6. Well, today, here's the big problem. Today, they're only going to 3 or 4. Why? Because they're doing so much research ahead of time. So how do we, when they're on property, I mean, we obviously have to drive them to go to the mall, but that's another issue. But when they're on property, why aren't we communicating to them so that they know maybe, you know, they didn't think about going to this store, but now they're there, whether it's a promotion or new inventory, new merchandise, whatever, and they'll go to that 4th and 5th store. And I think that job is now our job. And 10 years ago, it wasn't ours. But, you know, we have to take more of the burden. And we've got to provide better service. We've got to create more traffic. And, you know, historically, you know, when my dad was building malls, all that was, okay, we built it, we put the department stores, we lease it, we keep it clean. And we went on to the next deal. Well, now that burden is primarily on us, and we're going to have to do that through increasing the intelligence of the mall itself, and also being able to talk to the consumer directly, which we're doing slowly. Not you know, we haven't figured it out, but slowly. And I think that's one of the things that'll help us combat the internet. And I was listening to the virtual. I do think people are going to get out of their house, right? I you know, if not, then, you know, we've got other issues. But I do think that's the case.
Do you think about things like Amazon's more recent announcement in the grocery world, where they're innovating technologies that enable you to walk into a store, take something off the shelf, no longer go to the cashier, have a self-registered purchase experience that, to me, number one, enables people to have a happier, no lines for the cashier,
sure,
kind of experience, but also kind of brings back, I think, a mainstay of retail, and that is impulse purchasing.
Sure.
And, you know, you look at bookstores, you can buy a book online, but if I'd go to a bookstore, I'd walk out with 6 books, sure, that I'd never read, but I,
yeah,
you know.
Yeah, you're like me, right?
Yeah,
so look, I think technology from the store ops point of view is hugely important, okay? Because, you know, we all get frustrated waiting. How many times have we wanted to check out, there's a line, and you say, I'm not going to do it. And we're all at the point now where we, you know, We all have ADD, right? I mean, because of these little things that we carry around, right? We all have ADD. So I think the fact is that if there is store technology that can make the experience better, either through checkout, returns, finding whether they have your size, search, I think all that's got to happen. I mean, and I think because on the internet, it is too easy. It is really easy to shop online. So you have to have a better experiment. And unfortunately, you know, our retailers should invest more in this. You know, if you're in the physical world, invest in your physical product, right? If you're in the hotel business, right? Are you going to have a crappy looking hotel? No one's going to show up. It's not that complicated. If you have a crappy looking store, nobody's going to show up. If you have a crappy looking mall, nobody will show up.
So it seems to me that, you as a national retail center driver would have an awful lot of influence relative to these retailers. Do you talk to them about innovating within their businesses?
We do, but we've been, and this might shock you because of, my personality, you checked it out, right? We've been actually very sensitive to pushing them, hard on that front. And I'll give you a simple example, and you guys can figure it out. I don't want to name names, but there's a big department store company, that bought $7 billion of stock back, and they didn't invest in their stores. And you're an owner. You think like an owner, right? I think like an owner. And if you don't have an owner mentality, then, and the owners tend to think, maybe we don't know what's around the corner, but we tend to think a little bit longer term. And it was so easy, the math, when you run a public company and you're worried about EPS per share, what's the easiest math, right? You borrow at X, you buy your stock back, everybody can do accretion dilution, and, life goes on. But the fact is, what happened is they didn't invest in their stores. And it catches up with you. And I think, I look at Amazon as, one of the best companies ever created. And, what separates them from everybody? They invest. They invest in everything that they do. Whether it's, some of it's PR, like the drones, but, Charlie, I happen to be by this little conference room. Remember that on, Black Friday? Look, there's a drone flying around. But besides that, they do invest in their business. And right now in the retail world, I just don't see a lot of conviction. But I think we got to take it upon ourselves to force the issue a little bit. And we're the entrepreneurs today. Look at the restaurant business. Look how it's evolved from 10 years ago, right? Where, 10 years ago there was very few places to really eat in a beautiful, look at South Florida, look at all the restaurants, you can't keep up with them, right? But, so there are entrepreneurs out there changing the dynamics. A lot of those want to locate in mall, and it creates a great vibe. I'd like to see that on the, what I'll call outside the restaurant, on the retail side. And it's interesting, we're seeing the pure online guys realizing that in order to really create value beyond pure online, to acquire customers cheaper, etc., they're opening physical stores. So
that's the other side of Amazon. Opening bookstores.
Yeah, that's where it's going to evolve. But there's going to be pain along the way. I mean, they're going to be, it's not just the mall business. So, look, let's drive around Florida. How many crappy strip centers are there in the state of Florida, right? Everywhere, right? So, I do think you need critical mass, and I do think you need all these things to you know, to bring the customer in, but it's doable.
So let me, time's getting short.
Yeah.
You've got a plane to catch.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for being here, but let me ask
we got stuff to drink too.
Right? And we got stuff to drink, right. So let me ask a final question, and you know, we have some students in the audience. Yeah. We've got a broad group here, but some people that are just kind of starting out in their career. You know, as I listen to your last answer, I think about something I said earlier: getting out on your front foot, as opposed to being defensive. You talk about a big box retailer that bought back a lot of stock and didn't invest in stores.
Right, right.
That's defense versus offense. How would you characterize, within kind of your management style, the way you've run your business, you know, the way you would think about advising someone getting out in today's world and journeying into the world of retail or the world of real estate? How would you characterize, or what advice might you give to these people?
Well, I would say that work for, this may sound silly, but you're always going to learn the most from the best in the industry. So to the extent that you can, you know, land that opportunity with leading companies, you're going to learn, you're going to have a much better learning curve. And, you know, I was able to learn a lot on Wall Street that I applied, you know, it probably doesn't help me now, but it helped me, you know, a lot in what we did. You know, and I was at the foot of the masters, you know, Bruce Wasserstein, Joe Perella, you know, doing some of the biggest M&A deals, you know, in the world. And if you had that opportunity, then, you know, even though it may not be, you know, glamorous, I just, the opportunity to work for the best in the business, if you can do that, do it at any level, because you're going to learn that much more. And I think the most important thing in business is just having conviction in what you do. I mean, I think the folks that have succeeded at the highest level have conviction in what they do. And whether it's your business or mine or Amazon or, you know, a financial service, if you're convinced, you have conviction that you're doing the right thing, trying to make your company better every day, I think that's important. Sometimes it takes a while to sort through that, but you know, you got to feel like you you know, that you can make a difference.
Great. I think we're going to end it right
okay.
there. And I want to say this, David, thank you so much.
Thank you.
You honor the University of Miami and all of us in the real estate world by being here today. You're wearing
your
proudly.
I thank you for the pen, by the way.
And I hope you'll get out and tell others that this is a painless experience.
Right.
We want a broad group of people to talk to us about real estate in this community. It's alive. It's vibrant.
Right.
Come on back and don't forget to contribute next year.
Thank you. Thank you.